Okay, we're going to get started. So welcome everyone to Aspetuck Land Trust's Lunch and Learn series. My name is Jean Stets-Michelski and I'm the moderator for today's program. We are in for a real treat today as we welcome local landscape designer and artist Jay Petro to share with us his process for converting lawns to meadows. This is the ninth in our series of lectures to inspire all of us to improve biodiversity in our region by making small changes in how we treat our yards and gardens. So before getting started, just want to go over a few housekeeping details that allow us to have a seamless webinar experience today. For those who have registered and those joining us today, this program will be recorded. So everyone who is registered will be getting that link to view it. We will be utilizing the following features on Zoom, and you can find your Zoom features at the bottom of your screen by taking your cursor along the bottom. You'll notice there's a Q&A and a chat feature. Please drop questions and comments into the chat and the Q&A. I'll be curating them for Jay to answer all of the questions at the end of the lecture. So since this is a webinar, the speaker panel will not be able to see or hear you. We will not be using the raise hand feature today, but we will be monitoring the chat. So welcome everyone. I'd like to now introduce Aspetuck Land Trust Director of Landowner Engagement, Mary Ellen LeMay, to tell you about today's speaker and kick us off. Over to you, Mel.
Great, thank you very much, Jean. And so my role with the Aspetuck Land Trust is to engage people to take small steps in their properties that will help to improve biodiversity in our region. Our yards, our neighborhoods, our communities are the connective tissue between our close to 50 protected Aspetuck preserves. So that's why making changes like avoiding pesticides, planting natives, and rethinking our lawns is an easy way to help make our yards green card or stepping stones and allow for a free flow of pollinators, birds, and mammals across a connected landscape. So before I introduce our fabulous speaker, I just wanted to give a thanks to Jean Stets-Michelski, who has reprised her role as moderator of our Lunch and Learn series for the last year. Jean is the principal of Individual Differences at Work, which is a leadership and coaching company that helps to cultivate leaders who grow organizations. Jean is also a very longtime member and supporter of the Aspetuck Land Trust and lives in Easton. So thank you for your continued support, Jean. And I'd also like to thank our fabulous staff member, our Aspetuck Data and Marketing Manager, Shayna Meyer, whose magic touch with technology helps these Zooms to run smoothly and is also a steady hand managing our successful plant sale, our land trust website, and a million other things that she does behind the scene to make all of this, all these difficult tasks look so easy. So thank you, Shayna, for helping out today. Our speaker, Jay Petro, is not only a longtime supporter of the Aspetuck Land Trust, but is a landscape professional designer who is a very strong partner and proponent of the Green Corridor Initiative. Jay designed our very first Aspetuck native plant garden at Earth Place in Westport, which is now entering its third year. So we can't wait to watch it bloom this year. The third year is always a magical year for gardens. So if you get a chance, come on out in summer and see what the Earth Place garden looks like. So a little background on Jay. He's the owner and principal designer of Petro Gardens Landscape Design. Since founding his company in 2007, Jay has used his creative vision and horticultural knowledge to produce extraordinary landscapes for his clients. Jay is a former magazine art director who studied at the New York Botanical Gardens Landscape Design Program to facilitate his career change. 10 years later, he became an instructor at the New York Botanical Gardens School of Horticulture and is formerly the vice president of the Association of Professional Landscape Designers, APLDCT. Jay has also partnered with the Aspetuck Land Trust and the Connecticut Audubon on various landscape projects. During the winter months, Jay's an avid abstract painter and shows his work in various art centers and galleries throughout the Northeast. And his skills as an artist and painter is definitely reflected in his gardens. We are so proud to introduce our good friend, Jay Petro, and can't wait to hear your lecture today, Jay. Thanks for joining us. On to you.
Thank you so much, Mary Ellen. It's been a great trip with you and David and the rest of the Aspetuck Land Trust. I really enjoy working with you and helping out and learning a lot too through these things. So I'd say 3 or 4 years ago, we were going through a drought and I came up with this idea for people that they should replace their lawns with drought tolerant plants. And so this is sort of a version of that and it's morphed into different talks. But now it's, so now this one is, we're just talking more about getting pollinators and native plants and creating meadow gardens. So I come across as my role as a designer. I'm interested in helping the ecology and, you know, the insects and birds and so forth. But I also wanted to look good for me, for the clients, for the world in general. So I'm not, a specialist in like soil science. I'm not a specialist in insects or birds, but it all comes into play in our gardens. So here's where I grew up in Queens, New York. And this is, I sort of like this picture besides my siblings there, Stephen and Julie. I just love seeing like the forsythia and the sort of washed out holly. And it just sort of reminds me of where things were and how things have changed so much now. This is not your typical Westport or, you know, Connecticut house, but it could be. But I think the landscape is sort of typical for a lot of people. They've got just an expanse of lawn, some rhododendrons, some boxwoods. Nothing native here at all, nothing supporting the environment or the ecology. It also takes an incredible amount of water to irrigate all these lawns. 20,000 gallons of water a year the average lawn uses. Again, I was talking during our drought. We've sort of come out of the drought, but I think it's always good to be conservative with our water usage, and Meadow gardens don't need a lot of water. So why plant a meadow garden? I think all of us have seen these butterflies, the monarchs. I've got a lot of pretty pictures here that show the diverse, you know, wildlife that we have. Birds, all the pollinators. So why are these meadow gardens so drought tolerant? Well, this is a great picture. These roots were taken. They're 8 to 15 feet long. And so these are meadow plants. If you sort of have ever dug up your front lawn or a rhododendron, the roots go down only a few inches, if maybe 12 inches. So the point of looking around us and sort of taking in what nature is showing us can help us figure out what kind of meadow we want to, you know, put into our yard. This is at the Newman Poses Meadow, where the Aspetuck has taken care of it, maintained it. This is Storm King Art Center up in New York, across the river. They took out all these lawns and they put in meadow grasses. This was all done by seed, by landscape architect Daryl Morrison, who was sort of a proponent of using natives for a long time. And they finally saved so much in terms of resources here. Some of these are very simple. This is just in the front is a little blue stem, in the back is panicum or switchgrass. It's just two types of grasses, but it just looked gorgeous when I was there. This is at the Greenwich Audubon. They have a really nice meadow. This was obviously in the fall, and it was mostly goldenrod. There's some grasses and some asters. So these are very sort of, in a way, monocultural meadows. I'm going to go into different types of designs for the meadows. I'm trying to go through this pretty quickly, but let's start with why are we going to do this? Well, I think having these meadows give you a sense of place. Obviously, we talked about using less resources. They only have to be mowed once a year. Don't use any fertilizers. A lot of these are disease resistant, so you don't have to spray chemicals to support the plants, benefits to the insects, pollinators, and so forth. And there's a lot of cover help here for birds and mammals, small mammals, because there's nowhere to hide to nest when there's just lawn and a couple of rhododendrons. Thomas Rainer has a great book out. I have a picture of it in the back. What these meadows are, they're more like communities than individual plants set into the landscape. So they have specific ecological niches and they interact with their environments and other plants. So it's very different than just having a bed of mulch with a couple of plants. These are related populations, right? We're not going to think of these as individual plants. They're going to grow together and they're going to fall on each other. And they're going to all sort of be in the same place where the environment's right for them, whether it's hot, sunny, wet, shady, so forth. If you're going to create a meadow, it's not a bad thing to have sort of bad soil and to have it very hot, because having a stressful environment hurts the weeds more than it hurts these meadow plants, because eventually they put down these roots that we saw. Weeds are a huge problem with starting the meadows, and we're going to talk about that a lot. And probably people have more questions about that. But the idea behind this is to create these very dense communities so that the weeds can't come in. And how we do that, we have to have some aggressive spreaders within our native plants, such as switchgrass, panicum, and mountain mint, we were just talking about. Getting more into the design of these, there's different layers. So you want to sort of cover the ground fully with the shorter grasses, have some flowers popping up taller, and then maybe trees, bushes, or even tall perennials like Joe Pyeweed there. Part of what I do and part of what I think everyone wants is you want it to be attractive and you don't want it to just look like a big mess. Now, some of that is creating sort of hedges or some kind of borders so that it becomes, in a way, a formed space that's legible to read. We'll go more into the design a little bit later. And then in terms of maintenance versus management, you know, you're managing these communities. You're not taking care of individual plants. So meadow gardens. I think you can plant natives and non-natives as long as they work together in the same environment. Because of the deer, because of they are good for pollinators, a lot of non-natives such as salvia I use in a lot of my gardens. I think they're really attractive. But you can see from this picture, there's all sorts of plants going on here. Again, we talked about these various ideas about the meadow gardens. So let's start. How would we get to plant a meadow by seed? Assuming that you've got a lawn in place there, you've got to remove the grass. So there's multiple ways you can do this. Herbicides is one way. You spray, I use Roundup. It kills the grass off in a couple of weeks. Then you rake up all the debris and you get down a bare soil. I'll show you later at Earth Place, we actually used a sod cutter to remove the sod. And then the problem with that is you've got a lot of heavy sod, and you're taking up a little bit of the topsoil, and you're also disturbing the surface more than if you just were to kill it in place. Now, other ways to kill it in place are putting plastic over the grass, putting cardboard, newspapers. If you have a big area, that's really not practical. It takes a pretty long time, at least a couple of months to really kill off the weeds and the grass. But for smaller gardens, that's very doable. If you don't want to spray any chemicals. And I would say that if you're using chemicals, you don't want to do it on a windy day like today. You want to use the right dosages. You want to use it appropriately. You want to wear protective clothing. So the good thing about doing an herbicide, it's non-selective. It's going to kill all the weeds that are growing there down to the roots, so they won't just come back up. So that is one big advantage. Sometimes when you're cutting them, the roots are still there and they'll come up. So we seed over this area. We did this by hand. We mix the seed, which some of the seeds are really small. So you can mix it with sawdust. I use cat litter because I have a cat. And you basically get the soil like we were looking at, you know, bare dirt, throw the seed. First year, you're supposed to cut it back to 8 inches. If it gets above 8 inches, you know, let it go to 12, cut it back. And basically it looks like a bunch of weeds. The idea here is that you're cutting the weeds that are germinating from forming flowers and then going to seed, and you're allowing the new meadow plants to grow. And yes, you're cutting off their flowers, but you're allowing them to still grow. You know, you don't want to cut them too low. So the first year is what you do there. The second year, you just let it go, and then you're pretty much set. Now, this was taken in the summer, and you can see on the left that the lawn is really burned out because it was hot and dry, but the meadow is looking really good. So I think this is a great indication of how you can save on water conservation. This was done by seed. Deer were living in this meadow. At one point I saw that they had matted down an area. So they do eat black-eyed Susans. They do eat some of these things, but this was a disease, a deer-resistant meadow seeding. And yes, they ate a few things, but they didn't go crazy. This is Verbena hostata. What you saw in a couple of slides back there was black-eyed Susans, and this is Coreopsis lanceolata. So what happens with a meadow, you get these pioneer species come in, and those two are the primary ones along with Monarda, and they'll flower and they'll sort of look like the whole meadow is that one color, that one species, but these are sort of quick to germinate, quick to flower, and then quick to die. So they will reseed into bare soil, but eventually a lot of the meadow plants that you have seeded in will mature and start to take up space and push out the bare soil and cover the space. And once you're covering the ground, these plants won't be able to reseed. This was another one. This is black-eyed Susans. This is after the first year, so we just let it grow. The Monarda, if you seed like the entire area, certain seeds will do better in certain areas. So we've got the Monarda in the wetter areas, and the black-eyed Susans were in the sunnier, drier areas. And so when you do seed, it's hard to control how it looks. You are mixing what species you want, but you're not guiding every plant. And I do go into other ways to do this, which is with live plants. And here we go. So this is at Earth Place. The alternative to seeding is to buy live plants as plugs. I know that the Aspatuck has a plant sale and they sell these plugs. And they're very easy to put in, you know, start up, and you sort of go through the same thing. You have to sort of think about now, where are you putting them? What do you want the height to be? What do you want the colors to be? Do you want a mix of grasses versus perennials? Do you want more grass or less, you know, flowers? We saw some earlier meadows that were just all grass. This was a deer resistant palette that I'd come up with. You have to figure out what's the soil there. Is it wet, dry, clay, sandy? You know, is it shady? All these things have to come into play when you're deciding this. When you're throwing seed, they're going to germinate and do better in certain areas that are beneficial for the environment's beneficial for those plants. This is a way of cutting the sod. This is a sod cutter, and it's a very heavy machine, but you can rent them. The problem with that is then you've got all this sod and you've got to get rid of it, and it's very heavy. So for a small area, you know, you can do this by hand or you can rent a machine, and you know, you basically are getting down to bare dirt. Now you are leaving some roots in place of the, you know, the grass. So it doesn't do a perfect job, but it does a pretty good job. So I just want to pause quickly because this is, we're planting all these plugs and I sort of sprayed out the lines. And we do have a video that I wanted to show you of this. So I'm going to go for this.
I went to a garden party to reminisce with my old friends. A chance to share old memories and play our songs again. When I got to the garden party, they all knew my name. No one recognized me. I didn't look the same. But it's all right now. I learned my lesson well. See, you can't please everyone, so you've got to please yourself. People came from miles around. Everyone was there. Yoko brought a walrus. There was magic in the air. And over in the corner, much to my surprise, Mr. Hughes hid Dylan's shoes, wearing his disguise. But it's all right now. I learned my lesson well. See, you can't please everyone, so you got to please yourself.
So you get a sense of this is quite a undertaking when you have a big area like this. These are thousands of plants. If you notice, we use a power drill with an auger. It does go in a lot faster and it loosens up the soil really nicely. So that does help. And we had a lot of volunteers helping on this too. This was a meadow I did in Stamford. So again, we killed off, there was a lot of mugwort growing in this area. I did a very sort of detailed design here. I tend to try and figure out where I want the plants, and then when I'm there, I follow it roughly. So because I'm an abstract artist, I sort of lay out the plans, the plants, the way it sort of feels when I'm there. So I've got the right number of plants for the sun and the shade, but I don't always follow the plants. So here's what you can get when you do these sort of more designed meadows. You get blocks of color and you can mix the colors, the ones that you want. You can have two or three, four species. You don't have to have a mix of, you know, 20. So it gives you a lot more control. And I think it's different. I mean, to me, it's more design, but it still looks pretty wild. Again, all the plants are still growing into each other. And that's sort of the essence of these gardens. You know, the plants, there's not a lot of space around them. They're really intermingling. They're becoming a community of plants. Now, this is a very small garden. I've got a couple of pictures here. These are really not large. They might look a little bit bigger here. It's great to have a path going through these gardens. You can sort of wander through, see the pollinators and so forth. Mixing the perennials with the grasses, popping up, getting different heights, different colors. This is down by the beach in Westport, and the wind, when it whips through here, you know, these grasses look great, blowing. All different shapes. A lot of these flowers, after they're done, the seed heads or the flower heads, they're still interesting. They're sort of sculptural. This is called Rattlesnake Master, and it is a native, and it's pretty cool. These are the backyard, my backyard actually, where I've just got a bunch of grasses and I've been introducing different perennials. We took down actually a bunch of the trees off to the left. We had to take down, so it opened up like 20 feet, and I seeded a meadow there 2 years ago. So this year I'll wait and see where it's at. Again, these are not all natives. These are in front here. These are Korean feathered grass. They bloom late, like in September. There's a lot of these on the High Line, and they come in pink and they're just beautiful with the late sun. This is this purple flower is Verbena bonariensis. It sort of hovers over the grasses. It's non-native. It does reseed, but I'm mixing it with different panicums and eupatoriums and trying to get this just interesting mix of colors. You can mix these meadows in with evergreens, hedges. You know, it doesn't have to be just meadows. Here's a house. Now, I put in this sort of meadow garden in front because they didn't have irrigation and the sod was just getting totally burned out. So I put in some, you know, drought tolerant plants. You can even go to a higher level of design. This is Adam Woodruff. He's a great landscape designer, uses a lot of these perennial plants. Over here, these are all alliums popping up. There are some native alliums. These are summer beauty, they're called, mixed in with some echinacea. Again, it's a mix of natives, non-natives, but you can sort of see the patterns that he's working with, and you can really be an artist. And again, you can do this in a smaller space or a bigger space. The birds, the bees, they're not going to see it as beautiful. They're just going to go for the flowers. But we're going to see it. And if we're putting this in, why not make it look nice for us and for our neighbors? I just think this garden is extraordinary. And I include it to show people, like, just at the highest level what this can do. Again, here in front is Agastache, which is hyssop. And then there's Veronicastrum, those white flowers. Those two are native, but in the back is Calamagrostis, which is not a native, but it looks great. It's a very big, it's a vertical grass. So all these verticals I just found beautiful. In the foreground there is Amsonia blue ice. It's a low native cultivar. And that's mixed in with different grasses and salvia, which I just love the color mix here. And this is what it looks like in the winter. It's, it's still got some form, some sculpture, some color, it still moves. So it's not evergreen, but it's still got interest. I happened to be at this house when they were just planting all these plugs. Richard Hartledge is a very famous landscape architect out of the West Coast. He was working on this property. And then I saw on the cover of a book that he did, he had this picture. So I was like, wow, I remember being there when that was like, and then it was just pretty amazing. And that was all done with plugs, as you saw, and then these spread. So this is just one plant, but it looks pretty awesome to me. Part of with these wild gardens is sometimes you want to sort of frame them. This is a little bit more in the design, but put in formal elements, put in structures, lawns, brickwork, fencing. This is Bury Court in England. Peter Duff did the High Line and has done many, many beautiful landscapes all around the world. It's like a very classical, structure, architecture, and he's got these evergreen forms that keep the structure, but then he's using all these sort of loose, wild grasses. And to me, this all works. This was a garden up in Millerton, New York. I went for a garden tour, and these people, Jack and Larry, designed this themselves, and I was pretty much floored. But they got these formal elements, boxwoods and clipped hedges, with these loose elements. And he's got, they had a big meadow outside of this area, but even within their more constrained area, they had put in all these meadow plants. And these are all meadow plants. I mean, the mountain mint and the panicum, everything. Echinacea, agastache there. And they had this great Verbena bonaeriensis hovering over this lime green, I think it was a Cecilaria, which is not a native grass. So this was non-native. But again, they're mixing and matching. They all fit the same environment. And then the High Line, you've got sort of concrete, you've got the city as the borders. But then within these planting beds, you've got, this wildness coming. And I think the success of this garden has really changed how people view these kind of gardens and how they can fit in anywhere. Again, these are panicum coming up, and you've got the city, you've got apartments right over there. I mean, you could imagine this whole, meadow of these plants, but here it is just in a strip along the walk. And the pollinators, they're gonna find it because it's there, and they've got tons of pollinators coming and going. If anyone goes to Chicago, they should go to the Lurie Garden, again, designed by Peter Duff. It's hyper designed because there's these masses of plants. So it's a little more legible, like I was talking about. It's readable. It's not all a big mix, but it's pretty extraordinary. There's the rattlesnake master climbing up to the buildings. And the foreground on the left is the Allium. I think that's Millennium, which is more purple than the Summer Beauty. I tend to use that one a lot. The deer don't eat it. It seems to just be very adaptable to a lot of different environments. And they've got these stone paths, the beautiful sort of mosaic stone going through. So you've got this form, you've got the structure. So you don't feel like it's just overwhelming. And if you notice, all these are pretty low plants. There's a few taller ones popping up, but again, that sense of, you don't want to feel overwhelmed. You don't want to have everything towering over you. And there are some very tall meadow plants. Even after they bloom, these flower hearts structures are really sculptural and interesting. And I mean, again, this is another Peter Duff garden that's, to me, just beautiful. Playing around with different shapes. I mean, there's sort of endless possibilities that we can go through. So the more you know the plants, the more you can play around with these things. So I'm going to just go through now a few of the different plants that I've found have worked. They have good ornamental qualities. They have berries and seed heads that feed the indigenous and migrating birds. Most of these are highly deer resistant, so I use these a lot in my projects. Red switchgrass. Switchgrass is a native. There's different cultivars that are red, more blue, more tall. It's an aggressive plant, which is great to use if you've got a lot of weeds that you're trying to keep out. It's going to spread. Eventually, if it's in a mixed seeding, it may take over So you might want to use it in certain areas, not entirely over the whole area. I just seeded a meadow yesterday, and it's sort of at the back of a property, and there was a lot of mugwort and a lot of different invasive stuff. So I mixed in a lot of panicum, just because you need to fight back with these natives. On the right is little blue stem, which is a beautiful day. Panicum is good in wet. Little blue stem is great in dry environments, and it has, there's different cultivars, but some are more standing up. I think there's one called Standing Ovation. Some are more blue, some are more gray. A lot of them turn color in the fall to sort of a purplish color. Prairie drop seed is a great plant for just filling in spaces. It gets about 2 feet tall. There are different spirobolus that are bigger. It turns sort of this orangey color in the fall as well, but it's a good low grass. Pink muley grass on the right is sort of extraordinary if you've got a dark background like I've got in this picture here. This was actually in my backyard. It sort of looks like it's got fireworks going on. And this happens late in the season. So it's in September, September-ish. It is fine for around here. It's sometimes borderline for our zone. So maybe up in Weston, it might not be as hardy, though I did plant it up there and it did last for a number of years. Indian nut grass, it's a little tough to see with this picture maybe, but it's a tall prairie grass, and there's some blue ones called, I think, blue steel or something like that. And it's got these beautiful flowers that come up later in the summer. It's a big, tall prairie meadow grass. Goat's beard is great for in the shade. Less a meadow. These are sweet woodruff and foam flower on the right. These are more woodland plants. You know, a lot of times the area that you're planting might sort of go in and out of shady area. And so you have to sort of figure out which are the shady areas and where will these do well, and where the hot sunny areas, where the other ones will obviously do better. These are wetland plants. Most of you know irises. There's many different kinds of irises. Our native is the versicolor. The flower is not particularly long lasting, but the sort of the grassy fronds look pretty cool afterwards. Physostesia on the right, called obedient plant. There is a white version, and this is sort of an aggressive native as well. So there is one that's white and it's called Miss Manners, because it keeps to itself. It doesn't spread. But if you're looking again to have a plant that can take over an area and keep out the weeds, this is a good one. On the right, Agastache is just a great pollinator. I've got so many videos with the bees just buzzing around, and it's not always the longest lived plant, but it comes in and it's great. These great blue spikes are, you know, we use Blue Fortune and can't remember the other one, but there's a number of different ones, and just the native will be fine. On the left is a different kind of Eucara. Maybe some people are used to these purple palace. This one's called Autumn Bride. It's got flowers. It can take more sun than some of these, and I think the textural shift from with the grasses makes for an interesting look. I was talking about the alliums. On the left there is the Millennium, and the other sort of lighter pink one is Summer Beauty. And then Coneflower on the right. There's so many cultivars now, I tend not to go crazy with using them, all the cultivars. This one is like, if the deer are really out, and especially if you have woodchucks, this is not gonna work, unfortunately. It's called deer resistant, but it's hit or miss. And especially the woodchucks, and they eat the black-eyed Susans a lot. So you get the rabbits and the woodchucks and deer, and you know, so when you seed, it's like whatever survives. Culver's root, Verona castrum, is a great spiky plant. It's native, can take it somewhat moist, as is New York ironweed, which I think gets to 5 feet tall. There are some different shorter versions. I put in one called Letter Mani in the Earth Place garden. It's only like 18 inches. Great pollinator plants. These come in late in the summer. Verbena stricta on your left is a cool meadow plant popping up out of the grasses. And Monarda punctata, it's a different kind of Monarda. I think I have Monarda fistulosa later. It can take a lot of drought, and the deer don't touch this. There's Monarda on the left. There's a lot of cultivars of that, a lot of variations in color and height. Typically pretty deer resistant. They like it a little moister. On the right is mountain mint. There's a couple of different varieties. This one's Picanthemum muticum. It's an amazing pollinator magnet. It can be an aggressive spreader. So if you're, again, trying to keep out weeds, it's going to just sort of move out from its core. It's not going to sort of jump all over the place. But I use that a lot, and it smells like mint. And the deer, this is deer proof. Sweet fern is more of a shrub. But it looks like a fern. It actually likes hot, sandy sites, and the deer don't touch that one. Penstemon, I haven't used a lot. I've been using it more, and so far it does seem to be deer resistant. It's got beautiful flowers. Lanceleaf coreopsis lanceolata is, I think I was saying earlier, it's a pioneer species that comes in when you see early. And it seems pretty resistant to the deer. On the right is lead plant. It takes like a number of years for it to get to this size, especially grown from seed, but it can get 3 or 4 feet wide. I have these in the meadows that I've seeded. And what's interesting, they say that the meadow is going to change over 7 years. And so initially you're gonna get a lot of the coreopsis. And eventually this lead plant and other species of grasses are going to get bigger and bigger and start to take up more space. So they're sort of longer lived. And so the meadow changes over that time frame. So you just have to keep that in mind that it takes a while. Blue star or Amsonia, there's a number of different varieties. I use the blue ice one, which is short, but the Ubricti and Tabra Montana, they get about 2, 3, maybe even 4 feet, and they start to take up a lot of space. Totally, I haven't seen any animal eating those. Eupatorium, Hyssopifolium is, I don't know if people know Joe Piwee, this is in that family. It comes in late in the summer. I've been using it and the deer seem to leave it alone, but different herds have different tastes, it seems like. On the left, showy goldenrod is like 3 foot tall, very showy flowers. There's a ton of different goldenrods. They're all great pollinator plants. They say that they're deer resistant. I haven't used them enough to know for sure, but I think they are. And asters, you know, I have not used a ton. I'm starting to use more of them. I think that the woodchucks and the rabbits eat them more than the deer. So I'm trying them more. Hopefully it'll be all right. Achillea comes in all these different colors now. Most people probably are familiar with like the yellow version, which I'd shown earlier, but now they have violets and pinks, and these are really deer resistant and drought tolerant. On the right is salvia, which is not a native, but mixes really well with these plants in hot, sunny areas. And they're great pollinators. I mean, the bees are all over them. Helenium sneezeweed, I think is a really beautiful plant. Comes in sort of, tends to be oranges and reds and yellows. The native is pure yellow, but they have all these like salsa and siesta. They're sort of cool. The flowers last pretty long. I found them to mostly be deer resistant. When I put these in at Earth Place, the deer were, they'll go around, they'll taste them. And then by tasting them, they're pulling out the plugs that I just planted. So I go there and I'd see them all lying around the ground, but they weren't eaten, but they were like pulling them out. So I you know, everything does eat everything, but they say I use them a lot. Sunflower is a sort of taller plant, seems like it's pretty good resistance. Baptisia is an early spring plant that flowers. It's in the legume family. Seems to be mostly resistant. There's a ton of native ferns that I could go into, but the deer never touch them. Nothing ever eats those. So I'd say between grasses and ferns, you're pretty safe, but most people want some color. Blazing Star Liatris, it's a great pollinator plant. There's different varieties, and I think it's the woodchucks that once in a while will get at it. So, you know, it's, yeah, I put it in this one house and yeah, the woodchucks mowed it down. And so, but the deer don't touch it. So you never know. And then butterfly weed, Asclepias tuberosa, is a beautiful orange that, you know, is the plant that helps monarchs, you know, sustain themselves. So we try and put those in as often as we can. And they're very resistant to being eaten by the animals. And I like how the orange and the purples and the pinks sort of mix. Here's a couple of garden books that you might be interested in getting. The American Meadow Garden and Planting in a Post-Wild World. Now that talks a lot about the design and how to create these plant communities. So if you're gonna go into more heavily designed, if you're interested in that. Pete O'Duth has a number of books out talking about the different plants, how to use them. There's the native plants of the Northeast, and there's a ton of other books that you can look at. Now, in terms of buying plants or buying seed, here's a couple of places you can get them. Prairie Nursery and American Meadows have the seeds. Earth Tones, which is here in Woodbury, and Native, a plant nursery. My guess is that they may have seed, but they definitely have plants. And Gabertis has a number of things too. So, and then I should have put in that the Aspetuck has their annual plant sale, where they do sell these, the plugs. The problem with the plugs is they come in trays of usually 50 or 30. So you've got a lot of one kind, which is, if you have a big area, that's not a problem. But if you're doing a smaller area, some of the smaller gardens I've done with just 1 gallon container plants, because then you can get 5 of this and 6 of that, and you know, can fill it up, get more variety. The plugs are really good for taking up a lot of space and, you know, helping the plant. And I think that's it. That's my spiel. I hope you enjoyed it. We're open to questions. And hope there's some
Jay, questions. Thank you so much. And there are quite a few, some very lively conversation going on. So I'm going to start at the top. And if that would be okay with you, we'll move through.
Sure.
Okay, terrific. So right on the top, we have quite a bit of concern about Roundup and the use of chemicals. So people are worried about the toxicity, and they're curious about alternative ways beyond the sod remover that people on the call today can use.
Right. So I talked about using plastic to cover the area. So the heat from the plastic will solarize the weeds and the grass. You have to keep it on, you have to weigh it down with bricks and so forth. Probably for a couple of months, and you have to do it when it's hot. So it's hard to do that and then seed at this, in the same season. So that's one thing. People have used like newspapers and cardboard, basically to cover, to suffocate whatever plants are there. So
Jay, talk to us about the newspaper and the cardboard. What would people put on top to keep that in place?
Probably planks of wood. And it's probably not very practical for a big area. But if you had a 10 by 10 foot area, you could put wet cardboard, wet newspaper, and then put some planks of wood, maybe weighed down with some bricks or stone, and just keep it there. Yeah.
People were also curious about the use of mulch or topsoil on top of the cardboard.
To weigh it down.
It in place. Yep.
Yeah, I guess you could do that. It's not the same question, but we don't add topsoil to these meadow areas because, like I had said, that a lot of these plants like the soil leaner. So when you add topsoil, it's got compost in it and it's really engineered to force growth. And the thing that will grow the fastest are the weeds. So you don't want the weeds to grow. You want to give your meadow the best shot at getting going. So it's helpful not to like fertilize, not to have really rich soil that are going to help the weeds take over.
Also curious about the use of some of the OMRI organic certified herbicides versus a Roundup. What, if any, experience do you have with those?
I've used, I think it's called horticultural vinegar, which can burn you. So it's a very high concentration of vinegar and it will kill the plant on the surface, but it won't kill the roots. Roundup is absorbed by the plant and integrated into it and kills it at the root level. From my understanding, and I'm not an expert, so don't hold me to this, but they say that Roundup becomes inert once it hits the soil. So it's not going into the water systems. But again, I know this is a subject and Earth Place, when we did the garden there, they did not want us to use Roundup, but I know a number of other meadow makers that actually use glycophosphate or some similar chemical. The problem is when you have some of these weeds like mugwort or Japanese knotweed, the root systems are so extensive. So even if you were to burn off the plant or even scrape it off, you still have all the root pieces in the ground. And if they're gonna just come back up, then there's sort of no point in doing this. So I wish there was something totally, totally safe. I'm not saying that Roundup is not safe, but obviously everyone's reading the news and we use it carefully. We don't use it when it's windy. I use it in limited places.
Thanks, Jay. Yeah. So let's move on to some of the other questions we have. People were curious about just letting the lawn grow and then editing what grows, pulling out the weeds and adding plants. How does that work for people? How does that work for you and when you're offering advice to people about how to get going here?
So if you let the lawn just grow as is and add plants in between, the lawn is gonna sort of take up a lot of the nutrients that the water and so forth that the plants could use, just certainly for starting. So they might sort of choke off the plants, but they're gonna go to seed. The lawn is gonna go to seed because you're not gonna mow it. So you're going to end up having sort of a mix of sort of tallish grass that's not native. You know, our lawn grass is not native. And mixed in with these plants that you're planting. So it sort of becomes a mess. So we have not done that. Mm.
So Jay, some people are curious about the difference between a cultivar and a straight species when we're considering the use of native plants in a meadow.
Right.
And non-native, yeah.
So cultivars, for people that don't know, are things that have been, they're not necessarily engineered, but there might be some kind of anomaly that happens with the plant. They like the color. So then that plant is reproduced by seed or by rhizome. And so then you've got these Monarda with all these sort of crazy colors and so forth. There's a lot of studies out. What's the, you know, are cultivars worse for pollinators, better for pollinators? It seems like, and I don't have the numbers in front of me or anything, but some of the species are pretty equal. Some are, you know, the native one is better at attracting pollinators. However, the cultivar, it's not like it's a totally different species. It is going to attract pollinators. It just might not be at the number that the straight species might. I think if people's goal is to just keep to native plants and, you know, just have local things, that's fine. These cultivars come in because people like the different colors, they like different shapes. And, you know, I'm a designer, so I find it more interesting. And if my clients like the garden and they find it more exciting to look at, you know, then I think it's a win because there's still pollinators in there. So I'm not, you know, a purist in terms of not using only natives or not using cultivars. I do use non-natives, like I mentioned, salvia. I use catmint. I use, you know, other plants that we would know because they either provide color at the right time of year to mix with what I'm doing, or they're deer resistant. But they always have to fit in the same ecological environment. So they all have to be plants that like it hot and dry. You know, you're not going to put like an astilbe that likes it shady and wet with a salvia that likes it hot and dry. One of those is not going to do well. So you want to put them into these communities where they'll thrive together.
Thank you, Jay. And so when you're thinking about some of the plants and managing and maintaining a meadow, a question here is about Rudbeckia. When you're starting and the Rudbeckia is taking over early, will the other seeded plants then come up later? Do you have to help that along?
No, just let it go. The Rudbeckia starts to disappear over the years. Like I was saying, they're short-lived plants. So as they die off, they'll reseed in any bare soil. But if there's no bare soil, they're not going to reseed. So the other plants that are in there in the mix will start to get bigger and take over. So sometimes I don't use Rudbeckia initially, but it's good to have these pioneer species because you want to cover the ground to keep the weeds out. And that's what they do well at doing.
So a question here about a meadow over a septic or leach field. What recommendations would you have for someone who is trying to solve that problem?
I guess I wouldn't be too concerned about doing it. I mean, I wouldn't put it over your septic tank, but the leaching fields, I mean, the roots, even though the roots go down deep, they're not like tree roots where they're gonna start to interfere with the leaching field. So I think it would be okay to do, but I haven't done it. So no, don't hold me to it.
And people were curious, you had mentioned the vinegar and the potential for that changing the pH. Do you wash the area after? How do you handle that after use of vinegar?
You know, I used it in hardscape areas like gravel and, you know, where weeds were coming through the stone or something. So no, we didn't wash it afterwards. I would be, you know, it's a non-selective killer, so it's going to kill whatever it touches. So you'd be careful, and you can burn yourself from touching it because it's a very highly concentrated vinegar. So I just, if the weeds are going to grow back in a couple of weeks, then you know it's sort of endless spraying then.
Thank you. So people are having varied experiences with starting to create meadows, Jay. And so one of the questions we have here is that if you have areas that are patchy and filled with some weeds and you're on year three of a meadow, what is the best strategy?
So if there are certain areas that have patches of weeds?
Yes.
Is that what you're saying? So if it's, so that a certain number of weeds are fine to be in the meadow because the meadow plants are gonna get bigger and taller and sort of cover the weeds. So there's different varieties of weeds. We go through and either pull or cut invasives that are popping up or any kind of woody plant that might, you know, start to emerge, any vines like Mile a Minute. We go through the meadows and try and get rid of that as soon as we can so it doesn't take over. If an area became just inundated with weeds, like one area, I would then probably try and kill it off and start again in that one area. But if it's just a little bit here and there, you know, it's not like a weeded mulched bed that needs to be perfect.
And also, I think people were curious about whether you would add some plugs into some areas or seed it if you take out those weeds that maybe trying to outcompete what you've planted.
Well, that's actually a good question because one design method is to seed an area, but then put in live plants, plugs of the variety that you want in a pattern or design that you want. So you have sort of these groups of plants with mixed plants around them. So yes, you can do that either while you're creating it or later.
And so Jay, you mentioned maintaining the meadow and the question is about what do you cut that down once a year? How do you maintain it? What type of mower? Do you need a tractor? How should people go about managing their meadow?
So that's obviously a good question. I should have gone into that. We cut them back once a year, usually late winter, but preferably if you can wait a little longer to the end of March, April, it's better for the insects that are they're nesting inside these stalks, the dead grass stalks. So we cut back the smaller ones with a sort of long trimmer, like a hedge trimmer. We cut them and then we rake them up. You can use mowers, though it's a little hard if it's really tall, you have a lot of stuff. And then you can use tractors. So some depends how big the area is. My meadows at home are not that big and we just go through with this long sort of hedge trimmer. But then some of my clients, they get their guys to mow. You want to mow high as you can. And then if you've got acres or even, you know, I think there's one meadow that I showed there. They have a guy come through with a tractor and mows it down. And it's just once a year.
It's just once a year. Thank you. So any pointers for someone starting a meadow when you have to plant into existing grass? They're saying they cannot use an herbicide, sod or covering, sod removal or covering. So what would you say to someone who is looking to plant within existing grass areas?
So I don't quite understand how that's different than what we were talking about. You have to remove the grass first.
Okay, and I think that's the answer, that you do need to remove the grass. Yes. Person is saying, I have grass, can I just, you know, how do I work with the grass and create a meadow?
No, it just doesn't work.
Okay, thanks, Jay. Yeah. And what about deer ticks and mosquitoes? Talk about those in terms of humidity.
Well, I guess with any long grass, there's going to be deer ticks. We go through and weed them. I don't see that my guys get more ticks on them than when they're just weeding a regular. I mean, they don't get them. So I'm not saying that they don't exist. I'm just saying, you should just take precautions beforehand and afterwards to look. But I haven't found this incredible amount of ticks in the meadows. There are certain plants like the barberry, which is invasive, creates this sort of humidity within the structure of the plant, and it's a great tick harborer. So you're more likely to get it from that. But I know a lot of people are not afraid, but discouraged about having a meadow because of the ticks. And I wouldn't go walking through it if you're really concerned.
Right, so taking care with yourself as you're going through.
I think anytime you're out in the garden, you should check for ticks afterwards, just walking around. I mean, typically they're not in the mowed lawn areas, which are lower grass, but they can be, because they come off of mice and other rodents as well as deer.
Jay, and it's always, we get these questions a whole lot. And as you said, it's really about protecting yourself and being vigilant with the tick check. So thank you for that. So one question, someone has a shadier area. So any recommendations for shade grasses and flowering plants? The area they're in has a lot of moss right now.
So there are plants that can, I showed a few of them that can grow in the shade. But we use a lot of sedges and ferns and there's a couple of, there are other perennials that flower, and we're doing a project starting next week. So I was just going through this. There's blue lobelia, which likes it wet and can grow in some shade and is deer resistant. Sweet woodruff, Galium, which has little white flowers. There's Tiarella, which is, forgot the common name. There are some plants, but you're gonna do well with sedges, which are like grass-like plants, but they're called sedges and they like it shady and wet, or shady, and ferns, I actually had some pictures of that, and I took them out just to try and get us down time-wise.
Oh, thank you so much for that. So people are considering meadows, full sun meadows, and they're wondering, are there any guidelines you use for determining the amount of sun there is in an area by observing unleafed out trees right now, so they can help to do some planning about right place for a full sun meadow?
It should have at least 6 hours of sun, and the more the better. I mean, full sun all day would be best. And I think when you get these mixed seeds, some of the species will do better in some part shade and part sun, part shade. Others will do better in hot full sun. So they'll sort of naturally just start to grow in those areas that work for them. But you should be observant of the day fully, and better when there's leaves on it. Yeah, leaves on the trees.
Right. Thank you. So we have about 7 questions to round out our session today. And one of them has to do with a border plant. Are there evergreens that'll work as a meadow border that you would suggest? What evergreens might work as a meadow
border? Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of evergreens. I mean, you saw some of the pictures where we did have the meadow. They had, we've used Norway spruce and white pine, you know, any evergreen. I mean, I wouldn't do a line of plants because a meadow is sort of naturally non-patterned, and so to have this sort of straight line of evergreens would be a little bit disruptive, but unless you were, you know, I was talking about having frames, and you might want to frame, so then you could use boxwood hedges and you could have a meadow. I mean, it's really, you could use any evergreens. I don't typically use rhododendron anyway, because they're a mountain plant, you know, mostly from China and Japan, but they like it shady and moist, and you would never see them with like a meadow. So I wouldn't put them together. You know, I often see like down by the beach, people put rhododendrons and seagrasses, as people call them. And they just don't, it seems very jarring to me to have plants that are from different environments in the same place. It's like, you know, I think that's what these meadow gardens are trying to create, a community of plants that would naturally grow in the same kind of environment. So I would be a little cautious about using some.
Thank you. A question about how much to water initially when you are establishing a meadow.
So if you're seeding, you want to just keep it a little bit wet, maybe once a week. Depends what time of year you're seeding. Now is a good time to be seeding a meadow. Pretty much past like mid-June, you don't want to throw down seed. And I actually didn't get into this, but the time for seeding is really like March to early June, and then you could do September through mid-October. You don't really want to seed sort of when it's not freezing, like November, because we could have warm days, the seeds could germinate, and then the cold will kill them. So it's okay to actually seed late November, December, when we're not going to get those warm days, the seeds aren't going to germinate. So they'll germinate when the spring comes. And then in the middle of the summer, it's too hot. So in terms of watering, you want to try and keep it moist until the plants are more established. And with plugs, I mean, depends again on the soil, how much sun is getting, but I think, you know, after the first week or two, like twice a week would be fine to keep them going. Yeah.
Thanks so much. And you should.
I should say, after everything's established, they should not require any additional water.
Great. Thank you. So, one question. About after you've cut down your meadow once a year, do you remove everything that you've cut?
So you can mulch it or chop it up. You can, in certain places, burn it, and you don't have to cut it then. You can actually burn it. We don't do that around here, so I haven't experienced that, but that is a technique that people do, and it doesn't hurt the plants. We take it away. We manually take it away because we're not dealing with huge properties. I think if you're dealing with a half acre, you just mow it and just leave it in place. You know, it breaks down and the meadow comes back up.
Terrific. Thank you. And you had mentioned one or two native ferns in your presentation. I know you were talking about the sweet fern. Are there some other native ferns that you would recommend?
Yeah, I mean, I use ostrich ferns, which are really pretty aggressive spreading. Cinnamon fern, royal fern. You know, if it's a sunnier spot, sometimes lady ferns can deal with some more sun. And there's a Japanese beech fern, which is not native, but it's one that can take it a little hotter, or sunnier than some of these other ferns. Hay-scented fern can grow in sun. It's native. It's a very aggressive spreader, and you have to be careful that it doesn't spread everywhere that you don't want it. But if you want to cover an area, it's probably a pretty good one to cover, you know, start out with.
And we're going to round up the question with a seed question. As we know, some of the native seed requires cold stratification. So what would you recommend? What types of seed that you might be putting into the meadow would require that?
To tell you the truth, I don't know. If we seed it in the spring, like around now, whatever needs to go through that process, we'll go through it next winter, and then we'll emerge the following year.
Right.
If you put it in November, December, it's going to get that cold, and it should come out fine the next year. But I don't take little seeds and put them in the, you know, freezer to get them ready.
Right. Well, Jay, I want to thank you so much for answering all of these questions. And boy, did this group have a number of challenging questions for you today. So thank you so much for meeting them with this amazing energy and all of your knowledge. And thank you so much for what you do. And I know, Mel, we're going to bring this back over to you. And there was a question about where people can find partners to be able to create meadows in addition to reaching out to Jay. And that would put Mel be on the Aspetuck Land Trust site on who the partners might be.
That is true. We have a list of maybe a half a dozen, and Jay is on that list, landscape partners on our website that you can go to who can help you for design and build. And they can help you with meadow restoration like this. And you know, it's getting more and more popular, and folks can start it small and continue to make it bigger every year. So, you know, it's kind of a year over year journey with gardening, especially with natives, and finding out what works and what doesn't work. So just kind of be patient with yourself and patient with what shows up. I'm sure Jay agrees, and you know, I think we'll be surprised sometimes when we can, you know, I'll plant a native plant like Pearly Everlasting, which is just an incredible plant, and next to it I'll put some lesser catmint, which is not native at all, and the bees surprisingly are all over the native catmint but not on the Pearly Everlasting. And I'm like, you guys are supposed to be here. So they choose, and they choose colors too. Some plants like asters, the true asters, can be covered with bees, and then they'll fly right over a cultivar aster just because they don't like the color. So there's a lot of really interesting research going on between the nativars and the cultivars. And I put a link into the chat to look for Annie White's research at University of Vermont. And she's really diving into this to understand why pollinators want certain things and what they want. So, and we'll kind of learn what the bees go to. That's how I buy plants. I see what's covered with bees, and that's what I buy. So, but yes, go to our website for a couple of things. Get your you know, landscape partner recommendations, including Jay. Our plant sale, our native plant sale, is still open online. You can go to our website. We'll keep it open for probably another week. And this year we are offering quarts and gallons, as Jay said, for gardens. Sometimes it's better to have bigger plants to get in there. And we do offer the plugs as well. So tomorrow is our spring ephemeral hike in Trout Brook Valley. You can get online and sign up for that. And next Thursday, we're not having a lunch and learn next week. We're having a walk and talk. So we have an opportunity to go out with Charlie Stebbins live and walk through the Audubon, Connecticut Audubon, Smith Richardson Preserve, and actually join in, see some of the work and the transformation that's going on at Smith Richardson. So we'll be out tomorrow with Spring Ephemerals and out next Thursday with Smith Richardson, which is in Westport. So one other thing I just wanted to comment was with the herbicides. I know that's just, it's just such a challenge now for everyone to balance. And we've been trying hard to find alternatives to glyphosate. And there's a couple that we're trying out at some of our preserves that are OMRI certified. So if you look for OMRI, that's an organic certification. We're trying Finalsan, which is called F-I-N-A-L-S-A-N. That's how that's spelled. The other one is Phydura, P-H-Y-D-U-R-A. And the last one is Avenger. And those are three OMRI certified herbicides that we're trying out in certain areas and just to see if that works. Because when you have a, when you're a land trust and you have, you know, 5 to 7 acres of mugwort, it's really a challenge to, you know, manage that stuff by hand. So everyone's out looking for alternatives to glyphosate. And, you know, we've joined on the bandwagon as well, especially when you're trying to get pollinators into your meadow. It's always good to be cautious. So we're all trying, we're all learning together. Everyone's been great in the chat with sharing some of their personal experiences, which is how I learn a lot of times. So, and I'm just so happy that we had Jay on here today. He's been working so hard with us for the last 3 years at Aspetuck with his designs. And it was just such a beautiful presentation. We had a lot of great comments about how beautiful your photographs are and that you should design a book. So there should be your own book that we can show maybe in another couple of years, a coffee table book by Jay Petro.
That would be nice.
Yeah, it would be wonderful. So thanks everybody for joining today. It has been recorded. Everyone who's registered, we will send a recording to, and it will sit on our Aspetuck website so forever. So you can go back and watch it every time, anytime that you want. So I wish everybody a happy spring weekend coming up. Get out there and see what's coming up out of the ground. And hopefully you take some of Jay's ideas and begin to transform your landscape. So thank you again for getting on, and have a great weekend, everybody.
Thank you for having me. I really appreciate it, the opportunity. It's great. And it's a great organization, and anything I can do to help, I really would like to.
It's our pleasure. And we're delighted to have you as such a good partner. So thank you, Jay. And everybody that got on today, it was an overwhelming participation rate. We get two thumbs up for this day. So thank you, Jay.